thank you, and good evening to all of you. Our board has today approved the financial results of ICICI Bank for the quarter ended 31st December 2017. The bank continues to make progress on the strategic priorities that we had outlined in our 4x4 agenda, which covers portfolio quality and enhancing franchise. I would just like to highlight a few areas pertaining to this quarter in that context. First of all, talking of loan growth, during the quarter we saw accelerated growth in our loan book and also the portfolio mix improved further. The domestic loan growth increased to 15.6% year-on-year on 31st December 2017, aided by strong growth in the retail loan portfolio. The retail loans growth increased to 22.2% year-on-year on 31st December 2017. We also saw continued growth in the domestic corporate loans. If we exclude the net NPAs, restructured loans and loans internally rated below investment grade in key sectors at 31st December, then the growth in the domestic portfolio, corporate portfolio, picked up to about 15%. And I would also add that about 88% of these disbursements in the domestic corporate portfolio in the 9 months of FY18 were to corporates rated A- and above. The growth in the SME portfolio also accelerated to 15.2% year-on-year at 31st December 2017. At the same time, there was a reduction in some parts of the balance sheet. The net NPAs, restructured loans, and loans to internally rated below investment grade in key sectors declined by 31% year-on-year. And the overseas branches portfolio decreased by 14.5% year-on-year. Despite the above reductions, the overall loan growth increased from 6.3% year-on-year at 30th September to 10.5% year-on-year on 31st September 2017 due to the strong growth in retail, SME, and higher-rated domestic corporate loans. This growth in the loan portfolio continued to be supported by an equally robust funding profile. Our CASA ratio was 50.4% on 31st December 2017, and CASA deposits grew by 12.4% year-on-year at 31st December 2017. Coming to asset quality, the gross additions to NPAs continued to decline. The addition for Q3FY18 was 43.80 billion rupees, compared to 46.74 billion in Q2FY18, and 70.37 billion in Q3 of FY17. The net NPAs actually declined in absolute terms during the quarter from 241.3 billion rupees on 30th September 2017 to 238.1 billion rupees on 31st December 2017. The net NPA ratio also declined to 4.2%. And there was a sequential increase of 160 basis points in the PCR on to 60.9%, including the cumulative technical prudential write-off, which means the balance sheet was getting strengthened further. The bank also made significant recoveries from non-performing loans. The recoveries and upgrades from NPLs aggregated 11.08 billion rupees in Q3 of FY18. The core operating parameters of the bank continued to improve during the quarter. The domestic NIM was maintained at above 3.5%. As you are aware, in the same quarter last year, the bank had 8.92 billion rupees of treasury gains and 0.82 billion rupees of exchange rate gains relating to overseas operations. So if we exclude the treasury income and the exchange rate gains related to overseas operations, the core operating profit actually increased by 9.7% in Q3 FY18. It increased from 45.49 billion in Q3 FY17 to 49.92 billion in Q3 FY18. The bank's capital position also continues to be strong with a core Tier 1 capital adequacy ratio of 14.19% and Tier 1 capital adequacy ratio of 15.04% at 31st December 2017, including, of course, the profits for 9 months of FY18. We continue to be at the forefront of offering technology-enabled services to our customers. Our debit and credit card transactions continued to grow at a healthy rate of about 40% year-on-year in the 9 months. Over 8.3 million UPI virtual payment addresses have been created using the banks and the partners' platforms till 31st December 2017. And during the quarter, the bank entered into a new partnership for digital lending to launch a product that seamlessly offers digital credit instantly. We have continued to strengthen our franchise with a focus on sustainable growth. We are well placed to capitalize on the opportunities arising out of the financialization of savings, out of the formalization and digitization of the Indian economy across the bank as well as across the entire ICICI group. And this can be seen in the growth of our retail-oriented businesses. In the corporate business, we continue believe that our additions to NPAs this year would be substantially lower than the additions last year, and the focus is now on accelerated resolution. We will continue to focus on selective growth. We will pursue new opportunities in this space as they keep arising. We are continuously investing and innovating in technology and the use of digital channels and digital methods to improve our customer experience as well as our own internal processes. So with this strong franchise and focus on capital efficiency, we will work towards enhancing our return ratios as we move ahead in the coming years. I will now hand over the call to Kannan.
Thank you, ma'am. Good evening to all of you. I will now talk about our performance on growth and credit quality. I will then talk about the P&L details, subsidiaries, and finally the capital. On growth, the domestic loan growth was 15.6% year-on-year as of December 31, 2017, driven by strong growth in the retail business. Within the retail portfolio, the mortgages and auto loan portfolios grew by 18% and 15% on a year-on-year basis, respectively. Growth in the business banking and rural lending segments was 51% and 25% year-on-year, respectively. The commercial vehicle and equipment loans grew by 20% year-on-year. The unsecured credit cards and personal loans portfolio grew by 38% year-on-year, of course, a relatively smaller base, to 275.62 billion rupees, and this constituted about 5.5% of the overall loan book of the bank as of December 31, 2017. We continue to grow the unsecured credit card and personal loan portfolio, primarily driven by a focus on cross-sell to our existing customers. The SME portfolio growth improved to 15.2% year-on-year as of December 31, 2017, and this constituted 4.9% of the total loans of the bank. The net advances of the overseas branches decreased by 14.5% year-on-year in rupee terms and 9% year-on-year in US dollar terms as of December 31, 2017. The international loan portfolio has now reduced to 14% of our total loans. Coming now to the funding side, total deposits grew by 11.2% year-on-year to 5.17 trillion rupees as of 31st December 2017. On a daily average basis, current and savings account deposits for the quarter grew by 14% year-on-year. On a daily average basis, our CASA ratio was 45.7% in the third quarter of 2018. Moving now on to credit quality, gross NPA additions were 43.8 billion rupees in the third quarter. The retail portfolio had gross NPA additions of 7.93 billion rupees in the third quarter. Of the last gross corporate and SME NPA additions of 35.87 billion rupees, about 29.79 billion rupees came from loans under the RBI dispensation scheme to the extent of 20.22 billion rupees. Loan to companies internally rated below investment grade in key sectors or the drill down list of 6.14 billion rupees, restructured loans of 1.97 billion rupees, and devolvement of non-fund based exposure. An increase in outstanding due to exchange rate movement related to accounts classified as NPA in the prior periods of 1.46 billion rupees. The addition to NPAs includes an account in the sugar sector where a change in management outside of SDR had been invoked and the promoters had entered into a binding agreement in the second quarter of 2018. We believe that the process will be completed in the next few months. Meanwhile, the account has been classified as a non-performing loan in Q3 of 2018. The balance gross NPA additions outside the restructured loans, drill down list, loans under RBI dispensation scheme were only 6.08 billion rupees in the third quarter of 2018 compared to 21.25 billion rupees in the second quarter of 2018 and 19.84 billion rupees in the first quarter of 2018. The net standard restructured loans were at 18.15 billion rupees, about 0.4% of net advances as of December 31, as compared to 20.29 billion rupees as of September. The bank has been reporting a further drill down of the portfolio in the key sectors, as you know. Our approach to the drill down list has been explained in slide 32 of our investor presentation. The aggregate fund-based limits and non-fund-based limits outstanding to companies that were internally rated below investment grade in the key sectors and promoter entities decreased from 195.9 billion rupees as of September 30, 2017, to 190.62 billion rupees as of December 31, 2017. On slide 34 of the presentation, we have provided the movement in these exposures between September and December. There was a net decrease in exposure of 4.86 billion rupees, as you can see. There were net rating downgrades of exposures aggregating to 6.4 billion rupees to below investment grade during the quarter. There was a reduction of 6.83 billion rupees due to classification of certain borrowers as non-performing. The above closing balance amount of 190.62 billion rupees includes the non-fund based outstanding in respect of accounts in this portfolio where the fund based outstanding had been classified as non-performing. Apart from this, non-fund based outstanding to borrowers classified as non-performing was 22.02 billion rupees as of December 31 compared to 21.19 billion rupees as of September. The non-fund based outstanding to companies in the restructured portfolio was 4.1 billion rupees as of December 31, 2017 compared to 4.15 billion rupees as of September. We go to slide 25 of the presentation. We have provided the details of loans under various RBI resolution schemes as of December 31, 2017 and we have also indicated the amounts under each scheme which are also part of the drill down list or the restructured portfolio. Comparative numbers as of September 30th, 2017 have been provided on the link slide number 60. As you can see, there is an overlap of about 17 billion rupees noted on slide 25 between the loans for which refinancing under 5x25 scheme has been implemented and loans under SDR or change in management outside of SDR. The amount of loans under various RBI resolution schemes net of overlaps has reduced from 135.04 billion rupees at September to 118.55 billion rupees as of December 31, 2017. The loans under the RBI resolution schemes that are not included in the drill down list or in the restructured loans has reduced from 31.54 billion rupees in September to 18.24 billion rupees as of December 31, 2017. As of December 31, 2017, the aggregate gross standard restructured loans, non-fund based outstanding to NPAs, non-fund-based outstanding to restructured loans, the drill-down list, and fund-based outstanding on standard loans under various RBI dispensation schemes not included in the above were 253.82 billion rupees compared to 274.10 billion rupees at September 30, 2017. As of December 31, 2017, excluding NPAs, restructured loans, the drill-down list, and the loans under RBI resolution scheme, the maximum single party double B and below rated outstanding was below 6 billion rupees. During the second quarter of 2018, RBI had directed banks to initiate insolvency resolution process for certain accounts under the provisions of IBC by December 31, 2017, if a resolution plan where the residual debt is rated investment grade by two external credit rating agencies is not implemented by December 13, 2017. At December 31, 2017, the bank had outstanding loan and non-fund-based facilities amounting to 100.61 billion rupees and 13.35 billion rupees respectively. The provisions held against these outstanding loans increased from 31.5% as of September 30, 2017 to 36.4% as of December 31, 2017. Of the above 18 accounts, insolvency proceedings in respect of 16 accounts have been initiated under the provisions of IBC. Now moving on to the P&L details, the net interest margin was at 3.14% in the third quarter of 2018 compared to 3.27% in the second quarter of 2018 and 3.12% in the third quarter of 2017. The domestic net interest margins was at 3.53% in the third quarter of 2018 compared to 3.57% in the second quarter of 2018 and 3.51% in third quarter of 2017. International margins were at 0.29% in the third quarter of 2018 compared to 0.95% in the second quarter of 2018 and 0.83% in the third quarter of 2017. We had mentioned on our last call that margins in the second quarter of 2018 were positively impacted by significant interest collection from non-performing and other non-accrual accounts. Further, during the third quarter of 2018, international margins were impacted by higher non-accrual of interest income on NPAs. Moving on to the non-interest income, the total non-interest income was 31.67 billion rupees in the third quarter of 2018 compared to 39.39 billion rupees in Q3 of 2017. Within this, the fee income was 26.39 billion rupees in the third quarter of 2018 and 75.86 billion rupees in the 9 months of the current financial year. Year-on-year growth in the fee income was 8.3% for the 9 months of this current financial year. The retail fee income in the 9 months of the financial year grew by 13.5% and constituted about 72% of the overall fees. Treasury recorded a profit of 0.66 billion rupees in the third quarter of 2018 compared to 8.93 billion rupees in the third quarter of 2017 and 1.81 billion rupees excluding the gain on sale of shares in ICICI General in the second quarter of 2018. Other income was 4.62 billion rupees in the third quarter of current financial year compared to 5.51 billion rupees in the third quarter of 2017. The bank had no exchange rate gains relating to overseas operations in third quarter of 2018 compared to the gains of 0.82 billion rupees in the corresponding quarter last year, which was subsequently reversed in the fourth quarter of 2017. Other income included dividend income of 4.45 billion rupees in the third quarter of 2018. Moving on to expenses, the bank's cost-to-income ratio was at 43% in the third quarter of 2018. Operating expenses increased by 1% on a year-on-year basis. During the quarter, employee expenses decreased by 3.1% on a year-on-year basis due to lower provisions on retirals during the quarter compared to the corresponding quarter last year. This reflected the increase in yield on government securities in the third quarter this year compared to the decline in yields in the third quarter of last year. The bank had 83,094 employees as of December 31, 2017. Moving on to provisions, they were at 35.7 billion rupees in the third quarter of this financial year compared to 27.13 billion rupees in the corresponding quarter last year. There was a sequential increase of 160 basis points in the provisioning coverage ratio on non-performing loans to 60.9%, including the cumulative technical prudential write-off, further strengthening the balance sheet. The bank's standalone profit after tax was 16.5 billion rupees in the third quarter of 2018 compared to 20.58 billion rupees in the preceding quarter and 24.42 billion rupees in the corresponding quarter last year. Now moving on to the subsidiaries, the profit after tax of ICICI Life for the third quarter of current fiscal was 4.52 billion rupees compared to 4.5 billion rupees in the third quarter of last fiscal. The new business margin has been continuously improving from 8% in financial year 2016 to 10.1% in financial year 2017 and further to 13.7% in the 9 months of the current financial year. The profit after tax of ICICI General for the third quarter of this fiscal was 2.32 billion rupees compared to 2.2 billion rupees in the third quarter of last fiscal year. The profit before tax grew by 43% to 3.22 billion rupees in the third quarter of this fiscal compared to 2.25 billion rupees in the third quarter of last fiscal. The gross written premium of ICICI General grew by 18.1% on a year-on-year basis to 30.02 billion rupees in the third quarter of current financial year. Moving on to the ICICI Asset Management Company, the profit after tax increased by 22% year-on-year basis to 1.61 billion rupees in the third quarter of current financial year, with average assets under management of about 2.9 trillion rupees for the quarter. ICICI AMC continues to be the largest mutual fund in India based on average assets under management for the third quarter of current financial year. The profit after tax of ICICI Securities on a consolidated basis was 1.53 billion rupees in the third quarter of current financial year. The bank's total equity investment in ICICI Bank UK and ICICI Bank Canada has reduced from 11% of the bank's net worth as of March 31, 2010 to 4% as of December 31, 2017. ICICI Bank Canada had a profit after tax of 8.4 million Canadian dollars in the third quarter of current financial year compared to a loss of 34.6 million Canadian dollars in the third quarter of last financial year. ICICI Bank UK had a profit after tax of 1.8 million US dollars in the third quarter of 2018 compared to 1.7 million US dollars in the third quarter of 2017. The consolidated profit after tax was 18.94 billion rupees in the third quarter of 2018 compared to 26.11 billion rupees in the corresponding quarter last year and 20.71 billion rupees in the preceding quarter. Moving finally to capital, we had a Tier 1 capital adequacy ratio of 15.04% and total standalone capital adequacy ratio of 18.1%, including the profit for the 9 months of the current financial year. The bank's consolidated Tier 1 capital adequacy ratio and the total consolidated capital adequacy ratio, including the profits for the 9 month period, were 14.87% and 17.72% respectively. The capital ratios are significantly higher than the regulatory requirements. So to sum up, during the third quarter of current financial year, the bank has improved the loan growth, has maintained a healthy funding mix, has continued to focus on further enhancing the digital offering, and maintained focus on cost efficiency and capital efficiency. The bank's core operating earnings, capital position, leadership in technology, value-created subsidiaries give the bank the ability to absorb the impact of challenges in the operating and recovery environment for the corporate business while driving the growth in identified areas of opportunity. With this, I end my opening remarks. We'll now be happy to take your questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on the touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. Thank you. The first question is from the line of Maru Kitajania from IDFC Securities. Please go ahead.
Hi. Could you quantify our divergence? Has the divergence report, the final divergence report, is now with you?
The annual risk-based supervision process of the bank by RBI for FY17 has concluded during the quarter. The observations regarding asset classification and provisioning do not require any additional disclosure in terms of the RBI circular.
Okay, but would it be possible to quantify so that we can compare with other banks? Because this is a much lower number than what other banks are reporting. So if you could have the number, we could actually compare it.
No, since it's less than the threshold, we don't need to really, it's not required to quantify it.
Okay. And the other question I had is just on the steel watch list. So, you know, over the years, a lot of steel slippage has happened. And yet the steel watch list is a big enough number. So why would that be the case? I mean, this is true of the sector, right? Even for the sector, a lot of slippage has already happened in steel.
It's a large...
It's 44 billion.
Yeah, so if you look at the overall steel exposure, there are indeed, you know, some cases where, you know, these are, as we have said earlier, these are below investment grade loans, you know, in our portfolio. So there would not be enough reasons to, you know, upgrade these loans into the investment grade category. So in that sense, it's not that, you know, all these steel exposures are kind of, you know, out of wood. So these are the assets we closely monitor. It is not that we expect, you know, all of these loans to slip into an NPA status or anything like that. It's just that these are below investment grade loans.
Got it. And my last question is that if you see your provisions, you would be making your NCLT2 provisions in the March quarter. So why were the provisions high at 38 billion in this quarter, as in that there were no NCLT provisions? So it's general aging. I mean, is that the normalized level of provisions now?
As we have said earlier, the level of provisions, you know, is a function of the you know, the NPA additions and the aging of the NPAs. So to that extent, it's very difficult to kind of you know, talk about a normalized, you know, consistent number on every quarter basis till the NPA additions, you know, come down more substantially. So to that extent, this quarter, you would have seen that our coverage ratio also has, you know, gone up. despite the write-off that we have taken on some of the loans. So that is where the higher provisions are reflecting. And you are right that the for the list two of the cases directed by RBI to be taken to NCLT, the provisions will be taken by the bank in the March quarter, as required by RBI.
No, so the where I'm getting at is, can we assume that the total level of provisioning in 2H would be similar to 1H or much higher? How do we think about it?
Now, actually, only one quarter remains, so in that sense, it's very difficult to guide on a specific number. But indeed, in the March quarter, there will be the additional provision that will come in for the list two of the NCLT cases.
Okay, so if I can just squeeze in one last question that, the GLF, a lot of banks have openly reported that there was one steel account which was upgraded and downgraded during the quarter for some, and then, downgraded earlier and upgraded for some in this quarter. So what would be our status on the account? Did it follow the same procedure of upgrade and downgrade?
We will not be able to comment on what other banks have commented on a specific loan which is not named, no?
Yeah, but the name is quite obvious.
Yeah.
And you've given enough details. Yeah.
They don't comment on specific.
No, I can only supplement by saying that the recovery of seen of about 11.08 billion rupees during the quarter, that is broad-based across several accounts. There is no lumpiness in terms of recovery, that I can confirm.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thanks.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Kunal Shah from Edelweiss Securities. Please go ahead.
So again, coming back to the divergence, just one thing, even though it's difficult to quantify, but in terms of the treatment, okay, so whatever would have been the divergence as of 31st of March, how would be the treatment of that as of 31st of December? So are they already in the NPL or they would be outside of it?
All the asset classification, which are required to be done, would be fully reflected on December 31st.
Okay, so whatever would have been there, it's already there in 31st December. Okay, and on IBC, so excluding those two accounts which have not been referred, if we have to look at the provisioning, so what would be that quantum if we have to look at it? Because then maybe the additional provisioning might not be needed if we just exclude those two accounts, because on the overall exposure, it seems to be 36%, but if we exclude those two accounts, then it could be much higher.
It won't, change the number substantially, so in that sense.
Okay, it won't change much. And just lastly, one thing in terms of the overseas operations, so the NIMs have been quite lower. So how would be the profitability and what was the reason for this very low NIMs in case of the overseas? So was maybe there are some reversals out there in that overseas operation? How is it?
So in the overseas, in the last quarter, we had talked about the fact that we had a high level of interest collections from some of the non-accrual accounts. So that would not have been there in the current quarter. We of course have had NP additions in the overseas book, which are all largely linked to the Indian corporates itself. So that is where the margins have come down. As you know, over the last 12 or 18 months, we have also not been growing the overseas book. So because the level of NPAs are higher, and incrementally we have not grown the book, what it does is that it kind of impacts the margin more than it would do if we were growing that portfolio at 20% and making new loans at the normal margins. So that is why it kind of shows up as a much sharper reduction than otherwise it would have done. For the current quarter, there was also we had a fair bit of liquidity in the overseas branches. We had done a bond issuance. Some of the issuance cost of the bond also comes in upfront. So all of this factor kind of combined, to be at about 30 basis point of margin for the quarter. But indeed, the biggest factor is the non-accrual of income on the NPAs and other loans which are under an RBI dispensation schemes. So to that extent, it will take time, for the overseas margin to recover. But overall, because the book has actually not been growing, the aggregate margins of the bank are not, as much impacted by this as you would have seen, for the quarter. Because at the overall levels, the margin, impact has more come from the fact that in the previous quarter, we had interest collected on income tax refund, which is, you know, absent in the current quarter.
But our profitability would be much lower. So is it a loss in the overseas, or it is still a profitable operation post this kind of a margins?
I think if you look at our, you know, segmental numbers, you would see that on the corporate portfolio at the current point of time, on the aggregate portfolio, you know, given the level of provisions, it would, you know, reflect a loss. But that is, you know, coming from the past book of non-accrual and the provisioning. In terms of incrementally what we are writing today, either on corporate side or to whatever limited extent we are doing on the overseas book, there the profitability continues to be healthy. But yes, the past book is impacting that, and that's true for the, you know, entire corporate portfolio of, you know, all the banks which have been in these loans in the past.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you, and all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Prakash Kaparia from Anivate Portfolio Management Services. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for taking my question. Two questions, you know. On the retail side, you know, were we, you know, extra conservative in cross-selling, you know, unsecured portfolio and, you know, personal loans to our existing ICICI Bank customers till now? Or, you know, were there no specific, you know, targeting or profiled customers which were targeted? Because now, you know, we are seeing a very high growth and, you know, some sense on, you know, existing customer base. If I look at, you know, there are 40 million account holders, how many of them, you know, own a credit card internally? What is the room to grow? And, you know, are we comfortable growing this book to, say, beyond single digits of overall advances in the near future?
Overall, if you look at the last, you know, 2 or 3 years, the book has been, you know, growing at a pretty healthy, you know, pace.
Right.
Before that, you know, we were, you know, not growing that book, you know, as much. So indeed, the amount of cross-selling that we were doing across personal loans and credit cards was much lower. So if you look at, you know, currently about, you know, 70% of the business that we are doing is with the existing, you know, customers of the bank. So we believe there is enough, you know, scope for us to cross-sell and, you know, grow the portfolio. In terms of the overall numbers, it is still, you know, overall a smaller part of the portfolio. So, you know, a 30-40% kind of a growth rate has to be seen in that, you know, context.
Sure, I understand that. But is there, you know, sufficient room to grow, say, if we have 4 million credit cards out of, say, you know, 4 crore kind of account holders for savings, what is the room to grow? How many?
Yeah, if you look at that kind of a comparison, there will be, you know, more than sufficient room to grow. But I guess the issue will be that, you know, it's not that to all the customers we will be able to sell.
Yeah, absolutely. So, say, in terms of our addressable segment, we can double those. So, if, you know, out of 40 million is, you know, 8 million a relevant number which we think we can get towards some direction sense, not a specific number.
So, we of course have those, you know, numbers, and we have, you know, pre-qualified offers for our customers, you know, for, you know, credit cards, personal loans, and actually for, you know, all the other, you know, secure retail products also. We have not disclosed any specific numbers on that, you know, per se, because it will be difficult to kind of, as I said, you know, some of these customers will, you know, end up, you know, maybe using other bank cards also. So that's why it's difficult to give any particular number on that. But there is sufficient room for us to, you know, cross-sell to our existing customers, specifically because our proportion of these loans and penetration has been, you know, quite low in the past.
Look, directionally, we think we can say maybe double out of our base, we can double the number of credit cards in our risk-reward framework.
We could do that, but we will of course have to keep evaluating, you know, how the
sure, it's an ongoing process.
The environment is, so
that
we will not be able to make, you know, such a categorical statement, but yes, there is enough opportunity for growth.
Sure. And, you know, if I look at the retail after, you know, few quarters, it has grown, you know, 22%. So was it low base? What has changed? And, you know, is this kind of growth sustainable, and is it on the back of newer focus areas on specific SME or affordable housing, if you could give us some sense?
I think we were anyway, you know, kind of growing at close to, you know, 18-19%.
Yeah, 17-19%.
Yeah, 18-19%. There was, you know, some, if you look, you know, go back to December 2016, there would have been some, you know, slower growth that would have been there in that particular quarter because of demonetization. So there will be some impact of that, but we have always said that we should be able to grow it around 20%, you know, our retail portfolio. So we are broadly in that, you know, range of 18 to 22%, and you know, depending on the opportunities, we expect to continue to grow at that level. There's nothing specific in that sense which happened, you know, differently in the current quarter. The one book on which we have been focusing and that has grown quite well for us, though again it's a pretty small part of the portfolio, is the business banking portfolio, which has grown at a good pace. Other than that, you know, rest of it is pretty much similar trends to what we have been seeing in the past.
Understood. I'll come back if I have more. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Manish Karwa from Deutsche Bank. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. My question is on fee income. Like many successive previous quarters also, our fee income just is not growing as fast as what our loan book is growing, what our retail book is growing, credit cards are growing. You know, every line item, if you see from a balance sheet perspective, is doing extremely well, which probably could generate fee income. But it's not reflecting in fee income. In the past, it used to be corporate fees that were declining, but is it still the case that that corporate fees are still declining pretty fast?
Yeah, Manish, overall, if I have to give a color on the fee income, yes, the year-on-year growth in the fee income was lower at around 6% for this quarter. I would say that is primarily because of the base effect we had. Because in the corresponding quarter last year, if you look at our fee income, that was probably the best quarter in the year. That was the demonetization quarter where we could get more fee income. So that is also acting a little bit against us in terms of the growth which can be put out this time. And if I look at the fee income sequentially, however, we are quite happy to have increased it by 6% on a sequential basis. So I would say last year. So, but if I look at, fee income growth for a nine-month basis, it is at 8.3%. And we continue to expect that the fee income growth for the full year would be closer to double digits. That is what I can tell you. The 6% number I said was the sequential fee income growth last year. So the growth in fee income continues to be driven by retail businesses. Of course, some decline, as you mentioned, is there on the corporate fees. But as we go forward in the subsequent quarters, we expect that to be corrected.
And what is the proportion of corporate fees now?
Retail would be about 72%. So the balance is largely corporate.
Yeah, but isn't this was the same number last year also? Is it 70-30 or is what lower?
It's somewhat lower. Somewhat lower. Somewhat better in the 60s.
Okay. And why is there such a fluctuation on your staff cost, in this quarter versus the last two quarters?
So as I mentioned, it has been largely because of the retirals, where we do the actuarial evaluation on the retirals, and we given that the kind of yield pickup you have seen in the government securities, obviously the liability requirement, actually there is a mild write back, I would say, of retirals during that. That has been the reason for the staff expenses, the way it has moved in the quarter.
And next quarter, it should come back to normal trends, right?
Again, it really depends on the yields at that time. But as we said earlier, the operating expenses, what we had, we had mentioned at the beginning of the year, the growth, what we had mentioned, pretty much we are going as per that path.
So you should look more at the nine-month, trend, because for the quarter, what's also happening is that if you go back to last year, December quarter, the yields had actually, come down, quite a bit. So there was an impact whereby the retirement cost was, higher in last year Q3, and it's much lower this year, this quarter. So that will certainly correct in the March
next quarter.
Okay. And lastly, on your overseas margins, now unless recovery happens, this 30 basis point of margin is something that probably could sustain till the time recovery happens?
In the
overseas
term,
book?
Yeah, in the near term, it would kind of tend to be around that level, because, as I said, it's not that we are also growing that book, much.
Yeah.
In that context, you're right. In the near term, it would be around this level.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank
Bye.
You.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ravikant Bhatt from MK Global. Please go ahead.
Hi. So you have stayed course on asset quality. Like you had said earlier that the slippages would be significantly lower this year. You seem to be on course to achieving the same. Are you at this time willing to comment how it could be going forward further into FY19? What kind of asset quality trends, whether you could repeat the same statement for FY19 also, that the slippages could be significantly better than FY18. Is that a possibility? And also, if you could comment a bit also on the drill down list, since it stayed stable for 3 quarters now, what kind of behavior you would have seen qualitatively within those numbers?
So on FY19, it is you know difficult to comment. You know what most likely as per the current guidance from RBI, which is available, banks would be migrating to Ind AS for FY19. So that would change things substantially. But even if that were not to happen, what we can say is that if you look at the stress loans that we have talked about, the NPAs, the restructured loans, the drill down list, which is there, the non-fund exposures to these borrowers, plus the borrowers in which the RBI schemes we have used dispensation for classification of loans, that aggregate pool we believe should not really increase meaningfully from where we are currently, and we would see that coming off. That is something we can say confidently, but in terms of slippage to NPA, for example, some of the drill down list loans which are there, they are under SDR, where there is a timeline by which a change in management has to be done. If that doesn't happen, then it would end up slipping into NPA. So it's still kind of difficult to give a specific number on the NPA per se, but the overall stress, I think we feel quite comfortable about that. And like we had said in the last quarter, if we look at the below investment grade loans, other than this entire stress pool that we talked about, then the maximum loan outstanding is less than 6 billion rupees. So that again kind of gives comfort that that there should not be any single large slippage coming from outside of the overall stress portfolio.
Sure. And one quick question on the NIMs. Now, I think at the start of the year, you had talked of a exit NIM which would be actually lower compared to where we are currently. Since while answering the previous question, you had said that possibly the overseas NIMs, where the maximum compression has happened during Q3, over there they are likely to stay stable. If I understood you correctly, then can we assume that the NIMs, the decline in NIMs has kind of bottomed out and they're likely to stay stable to maybe positive going forward?
There are some market conditions we'll have to kind of factor in the sense that as you're aware, the LCR requirement for banks has gone up to 90% from January 1st. So that means that banks will have to maintain an additional amount of liquidity compared to the previous quarter, and plus liquidity overall has tightened somewhat. But we would expect to maintain our margins at around the similar levels. They can always be, some up or down, but we would expect to maintain at a similar, kind of level. But market conditions will be important to see, how things play out over the next few months.
Sure. So when you say similar, you're referring to Q3 blended NIMs, right?
Yeah.
That is right.
Yeah.
That is right.
Thank you. I'm done.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Rakesh Kumar from Elara Capital. Please go ahead.
Hello.
Hey.
Yeah, can you hear me? Yeah, thanks. So first question is with regards to the credit composition. There has been a continuous rise in the retail loan portfolio. So where would it be maybe 1 year down the line?
So we do not actually set any proportion targets of what retail should be and what SME should be as a proportion 1 year down the line. What we focus on is what is, how is each of the respective segment growing and what is the right growth that we think in that context we should achieve in each of those segments. So given that, currently the way the industry is growing, our retail portfolio is definitely growing faster than the corporate portfolio. So I think this proportion will go up, but it's not as if we are trying to get to a set target proportion there.
Yeah, see, the context of the question is that, in the recent, this PSU bank reform, which, of the government had come out with the reform plan and all. So, you know, apart from 6-7 large banks, you know, there would be a certain set of banks which would be doing retail, SME and agri kind of business predominantly. So the competition of, you know, of the private banks in the retail segment may get, you know, slightly diluted to that extent, maybe if I'm reading it right. So I'm just thinking that, you know, if that is to happen maybe in the next 2-3 years down the line, then what would be the strategy of the bank, private banks in the retail loans?
I can only say that the market has always been very competitive. Even in the last many years, the way whether retail or corporate growth, I think the Indian banking industry has been pretty competitive.
Okay. And secondly, the tax thing, could you touch upon like the lower tax rate, like tax write back this quarter?
The tax is based on the, you know, estimate for the full year, you know, effective tax rate. So it's not, there's no, you know specific, you know quarter tax rate that we look at. We estimate out the income for the year. And the effective tax rate for the year is what we apply for the 9-month period. So based on that, the rate was lower than what we had estimated in December. So there was a write back which you see. And the overall lower effective tax rate is because of the higher amount of capital gains that we have got in the current year and what we are expecting in the balance period of the year.
Okay. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Adarsh Parasrampuria from Nomura. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Question on risk weight. I'm just seeing that with the loan growth, there is no risk weight consumption. You know, off balance sheet risk weights are going down. Would you expect this to continue for the next couple of years, where it will be significantly lower capital consumption?
Again, you know, I don't think we should take a particular quarter and extrapolate it. Going forward per se, but directionally, if you look at the off-balance sheet, you know, we have said over the last 2 or 3 years that we would want, the overall non-fund-based, business to come down as a proportion because, as we see, the risk-adjusted returns there have been lower, and that's what we have done in terms of our capital allocation, and that is what reflects in the, current quarter as well. Otherwise, the on-balance sheet, risk-weight asset growth compared to the past, will be lower because, on the corporate side, we are doing a lot more of, better rated, exposures. We give some data on our incremental disbursements also that you can see. And the risk weights on, when we do, AAA, AA, kind of lending, the risk weights are lower there. And even on the mortgage side, the risk weights are, lower for the, smaller, ticket loans. So compared to the past, where we used to do a lot more of, project finance and other, BBB, lending, the capital consumption should be lower going forward. But you should not take the current quarter as a, as an extrapolation, for that.
I was just looking at the last 6-7 quarters. Cumulatively, it seems to be pretty low capital consumption. So like 20,000 crores of risk weight asset on a 70,000 crore loan growth. So.
Yeah, so directionally, that would be the case, because we will grow more in the better rated corporate clients, and we will continue to grow the mortgage book.
And second question, somewhat related to this, is also that if you and in various forms it was asked, NIMs, fees, you generally look at the operating profit line to assets, the core operating profit that's continuously been sliding down, right? So, and which, in other words, it's a lower operating profit growth to the asset growth or the loan growth. Have we reached a point in terms of NPA accretion, in terms of corporate fees, having come down to a point where the operating profit growth can now be in line with balance sheet, or there are still, complications because of which, that still will take some time?
I don't think immediately we will get to that, level, because there is clearly, some impact of that, for example, in the overall, margins, which is, continuing. But if you, go into the next financial year, I think in terms of, fee income and, overall, you know, translation of loan growth into NII, you know, definitely it would be, you know, much better than what we have seen in the last, you know, couple of years, because incrementally the business that we are writing is as, you know, is as profitable as it was in the past, adjusted for the risk. So we should see an improvement, but it's not that we'll get to that, you know, immediately.
You know, the reason why I'm asking this question is that, you know, even, you know, at the current operating profit level, you try and get to, say, a normalized credit cost, maybe in 3, 4, 5 quarters from now, you know, the core ROEs will still be like 12-13%. So I'm just trying to understand, when do you kind of, or what will be the points where, you know, you would expect that to significantly move, or this can be a long-term ROE for the bank?
I think from a longer-term ROE perspective, we believe, you know, we should be, you know more than that. But yes, you know, if you look at a shorter time frame, then and adjust, normalize the credit cost, the numbers will be, you know, what you're talking about. But you know, we think that, for example, on the margins, you know, as we see, you know some of the recoveries coming from the NPLs, as we see the you know, the net NPA ratio coming down, you know, over time, the non-accruing part of the portfolio, you know, will decline, and that will, you know, help in the overall you know, margins, you know, for the bank. And fee income is something that, you know, we have talked about, that in the current year, you know, we hope to, you know, get to double digit growth on the fee income compared to, you know, mid single digit in the past, and from there we should see a better growth, you know, going forward into the next year as well. So in a more medium term, we would expect, you know, the ROEs to be better than the, you know, the 12-13%, which, you know, which one can get to by normalizing the, you know, as and when the credit cost normalizes.
I'm just squeezing in the last question. 25,000 crores of, like, you know, you mentioned the non-NPA stress book, right? What part of it is where you would not be accruing interest, and where are you accruing interest? Just to get some sense of what's left, you know, left in terms of the NIM impact.
So if you look at the, for example, the you know, so there are various parts of the portfolio. So we can just take it, you know, part by part. So if you look at the restructured loans, which are about 20 billion rupees, on that, you know, as long as the borrower is, you know, paying interest as per the restructured terms, and it is not more than 90 days overdue, we would be accruing interest. On the drill down list, you know, which is the larger part of the portfolio, you know, to the extent that those loans are under, you know, any of the RBI schemes which are there, we would not be, you know, accruing interest on those. So, you know, the SDR, you know, where it has been implemented, or a change in management where it has been done. So on those loans, those exposures will not be, you know, accruing interest. So that you can actually see in the presentation, the overall numbers are there as to, you know, how much of the loans are there in these schemes.
Understood. Thanks a lot, Rakesh.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Nilanjan Karfa from Jefferies. Please go ahead.
Hi. Is it possible to get a sense of, you know, the total corporate book, how much is below investment grade, percentage number at this point?
We have not, you know, disclosed that, you know, separately. So what we have given is the same disclosure as we have given in the past quarters. That is for the identified, you know, 5 sectors.
Mm-hmm.
And for the balance, like we said in the last quarter, that the, you know, the loan outstanding is not greater than 6 billion rupees for any single borrower.
Okay. All right. Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Manisha Porwal from Taurus Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Good evening. Actually, my question has been partly answered, but then just to, at the cost of repetition, I just wanted to understand how are we looking at the loan growth on the corporate side, given that the retail portfolio is already catching up pace. And this I'm again asking on the basis of the certain reform measures which were announced with the recap of PSU banks, where, you know, like they had been restricted from the number of banks in the consortium had been restricted, and the exposure had been restricted to 10% in a consortium, especially for big corporate loans. So just wanted to understand, for a bank as big as ICICI, how important is the corporate growth now, and what is the opportunity for you all to grow that book?
So, you know, clearly on an incremental basis, there are opportunities, you know, which are there in terms of, lending to PSUs, increase in working capital requirements of some of the corporates, plus as the entire there could be a fair bit of refinancing which happens as some of the stress cases get resolved. So to that extent, there are a lot of opportunities. What we will do is that we will look at the portfolio composition. We'll try to keep it much more granular than in the past, and better rated clients, and that's why we disclose our disbursements to A- and above clients for the period, which is close to 88-90%. So as long as we are able to get good margins on this business, which is a function of how competitive the market scenario is, we are happy to grow this portfolio, and we believe that opportunities going forward will be there for us to not just to earn margins, but also to make fee revenues from the corporate exposure. So it's something that we will continue to grow going forward as well.
Okay, to that, if you can just specifically tell exactly if there is a consortium with only 6-7 members, the viability of how does the viability of a lending change for a private banker in the sense, just trying to understand if there is a restriction in the number of banks in a consortium to just 6 or 7, or if the PSUs are restricted, so it will reduce the opportunity or it will only improve it for private banks. In the sense, is this a kind of restriction in the sense, it'll not allow many the risk to be spread across. So would that be a good thing or a bad thing?
So I guess there is enough opportunities for private banks, so it depends on if it is a good rated client, where the working capital limits have to go up, and some members of consortium are not able to do that, then some of the other banks, including private banks, can pick up that share. Of course, in PSU bank, SBI is as active as it was ever, so that's a large part of the overall PSU bank share, where we don't think there will be any change in the market dynamic. But yes, for some of the smaller PSU banks, there would be an impact, and private banks will have some ability to take benefit of that opportunity.
Okay. Can I add one more question? These IBC accounts have time-bound resolution to them. So of the 18 accounts in IBC for ICICI, how does the trajectory or the scenario builds out? In the sense, how far is the first resolution, and what are the timelines that where we can see some actual big accounts getting resolved? Or because resolution is a key thing for
As per the RBI's first list, which was where banks had to file with NCLT, those cases got admitted sometime in July. So the process allows for 180 days, which can be extended by 90 days. So effectively 270 days is what ideally one would expect resolutions to come in. So one would see that by end of March, April, we will start seeing the resolutions getting concluded. Of course, thereafter they will have to get implemented as well. As of now, in a few cases, the committee of creditors has started receiving the bids that is happened for a few of these cases in the first list. For the second list, banks have filed with the NCLT only towards the end of December, early January. So the admissions would be more in January. So that will extend up to September, October, based on the 270 day timeline.
Okay. Thanks. That's it from my side. Thanks.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, that was the last question for today. I now hand over the floor back to the management for their closing comments. Over.